ऑपरेट हो रहा है, 51 ये थे
आई एरो यू नो
हाय सर। एरो इसमें
एरो कौन सा?
हाँ सर, हाँ जब
अभी पूरा
हेलो स्टार्ट करूँ का? हेलो इज एवरीबडी देयर?
यस मैम।
यस मैम।
ओके
यस मैम।
लास्ट टाइम वी हैव सीन अबाउट द फेरेंजियल एपरेटस व्हिच कंसिस्ट ऑफ थ्री पार्ट्स। वन इज फेरेंजियल आर्चेस, second is pharyngeal cleft, and third one is pharyngeal pouches, out of which we have already seen about the derivatives of pharyngeal arches. Now today we are going to see about the pharyngeal clefts and pharyngeal pouches. Okay, so pharyngeal clefts, what is that? You know that pharyngeal arch is lined by ectoderm from outside and by endoderm from inside. So what is pharyngeal cleft? When the ectoderm between the two successive pharyngeal arches, it dips down, separating the two successive arches. That depression is called as pharyngeal cleft. So how many clefts are there? As five arches are there, first, second, third, fourth, and sixth, because fifth arch disappears. So obviously there will be four clefts, which are numbered from cranial to caudal direction. Now, as you can appreciate in the figure, this outer side is the ectoderm, and this depression is called as the pharyngeal cleft. Okay. Now, these are four clefts, and they are present as a depression on the side of neck in the embryo in fourth to fifth week of intrauterine life. So there are multiple depressions along the side of the neck, and these are nothing but the pharyngeal clefts. They are of course ectodermal, and they are present opposite to the pharyngeal pouch. Yahan pe bahar se this is the cleft, and from inside there are pharyngeal pouches. So these are the clefts we are dealing now. What are the derivatives? Now there are four clefts. What are the derivatives of these clefts, or what is the fate of this cleft? So you know that four clefts are there. Now there is a width of the neck. So each cleft will be having a ventral part and one dorsal part. So fate of the first pharyngeal cleft. First pharyngeal cleft, its ventral part obliterates. Ventral part anteriorly it obliterates, while the dorsal part it persists and it forms the external acoustic meatus. So dorsal part forms the opening of the ear, that is external acoustic meatus, and the outer layer of the eardrum, that is cuticular layer of the eardrum or tympanic membrane. So outside, external acoustic meatus and cuticular layer, these are the derivatives of pharyngeal cleft number one. What happens to other pharyngeal clefts? Now as you can appreciate in this figure, this is the first cleft which is giving us the external acoustic meatus. This is the second cleft. This one is the third cleft. And this one is the fourth cleft. Now what happens? All these remaining plates, they get obliterated or they get covered by the overgrowth of this second pharyngeal arch. It will grow here. And can you appreciate this figure? Because I am getting some icon over there. So on this side, on the right side of the computer, can you appreciate it? This figure? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. So you can see the figure completely?
Yes,
because
ma'am.
I am not able to see it completely because the icon is appearing there. So here you can appreciate that it covers all these clips. Okay? So these clips, they are covered by the overgrowth of the second pharyngeal arch. Now, whatever slit-like cavity is formed here, because this is the overgrowth and these are the ectodermal clefts. So, ye jo gap hai, this is the slit-like cavity. This slit-like cavity is called as the cervical sinus. This cervical sinus is there for some time in the embryo. This is a normal phenomenon. But if it persists later on, then it may lead to a swelling in the lateral part of the neck. Okay? So first cleft is giving us the external acoustic meatus and the outer layer of the tympanic membrane. Second, third, and the fourth cleft, they are covered and they are buried under the overgrowth of the second pharyngeal arch. Arch bola, iska matlab hai, it is mesoderm, which is covered from outside by the ectoderm. And because of this, the slit-like cavity is formed between this bulge and remaining clefts. So here, whatever cavity is there, this is called as the cervical sinus. Now you can appreciate in the figure that this cervical sinus is lined by ectoderm from all the sides, isn't it? So it is lined by the ectoderm. It is gradually it obliterates and we get the smooth lateral part of the neck. So neck becomes smooth because of the obliteration of, because of this overgrowth and because of the obliteration of the cervical sinus. Okay, so now it is clear that initially the lateral side of the neck is showing clefts. There are depressions in the embryo, in the lateral part of the neck. Later on, because of the overgrowth of the second pharyngeal arch, you get the smooth part in the lateral aspect. Okay, so that is about the derivatives of the pharyngeal clefts. So only first pharyngeal cleft is giving us something, remaining all they are obliterated. But sometimes there it may lead to the pathology. So what is that pathology called as? It is called as cervical cyst or branchial cyst. Branchial because branchial apparatus. So why it occurs? This is because of the failure of obliteration of these clefts, particularly the second cleft. If it remains patent, then it is called, it is leading to the branchial cyst or the cervical cyst. Where it is located? It is located on the lateral aspect, of course, and it is located along the lateral or the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. This is the sternocleidomastoid muscle and these are the sites of branchial cyst. But most commonly it occurs near the angle of the mandible. So these are the sites most commonly near the angle of the mandible. This is the branchial cyst. Why it occurs? Because of the failure of obliteration of the branchial cleft, particularly the second one. Now, as this is the cyst, it may communicate, sometimes it may communicate with internal structures, it may communicate with the external surface of the skin, or it may communicate on both the sides. So, depending on that, what are the complications or what is the sequelae of this cervical cyst? This is the figure showing lateral aspect of the neck with a swelling. So one of the differential diagnoses of swelling and on the lateral aspect of the neck, the most common condition in the this lateral cervical lateral swelling is the cervical cyst or the branchial cyst. Okay, you will come across these cases in the surgery. So this cyst is present as smooth, slowly enlarging lateral mass in the neck. It may not be seen at the birth, but it may or may not be seen at the birth, but it will increase with the upper respiratory tract infection. Okay, it may increase in the size with the age. Okay, so it is a smooth lateral a smooth mass on the lateral aspect of the neck. It may or may not be present at the time of the birth. It may increase with the age, or it is increased in upper respiratory tract infection. And as you know, it is lined. Sometimes this cyst is lined by stratified squamous epithelium, or it may be lined with the columnar epithelium. What is the treatment of this cyst? This cyst we can remove surgically, but if you remove it incompletely, then it will lead to, or it will reoccur, or recurrence is there. Okay? So incomplete removal can lead to recurrence. This is normal about the cyst. So this is the cyst. Its signs, symptoms, pathology and treatment. Sometimes this cyst may communicate with the internal structure, sometimes it may communicate with the external structure, or sometimes it will communicate on both the sides. So depending on that, we can get the complete branchial fistula. Complete branchial fistula means the cervical cyst will communicate with the inside or inner aspect with the pharynx in the tonsillar region. And externally it communicates on the skin. So it is showing the communication on both the sides. So this becomes the complete cervical fistula. Second is, this is a figure showing the internal branchial fistula. This is the cervical cyst, this one, and it is showing the communication with the internal structure. It is with the tonsil, and it is showing communication with the tonsillar region. Tonsil is present in the pharynx. You have already studied about the pharynx now. So this cyst is communicating with the pharynx in the tonsillar region. So internal communication is there. That is why it is called as the internal branchial fistula or internal branchial sinus. Okay. In the second figure, you can see this is the cervical cyst, and it communicates on the external aspect on the skin. So this becomes the external branchial fistula or external branchial sinus. So these are the sequelae or complications of the cervical cyst or the branchial cyst. Okay. Now, something you should know more about this cleft. As you know that each cleft will be having the ventral part and the dorsal part. Only first cleft is giving us something that is external acoustic meatus, and remaining clefts, they are obliterated, or they get obliterated because of the overgrowth of the mesodermum of the second pharyngeal arch. But before their regression, the dorsal part of these ectodermal cells, or dorsal part of the ectodermal cells, they proliferate and they give us some swelling. They are called as the placores, and they are called as the epibranchial placores. And these placores, they contribute to the sensory ganglia of the 5th, 7th, 9th and 10th cranial nerves. Okay, so ectodermal cells, they proliferate at the dorsal end of 1st, 2nd and the 4th pharyngeal clefts. On the dorsal aspect, the proliferation of the ectodermal cells is there, and they form the epibranchial placores. These epibranchial placores later on give us the sensory ganglia of 5th, 7th, 9th and 10th cranial nerves. You can remember these nerves because all these are the nerves supplying pharyngeal arches. Last time we have seen, 5th nerve is the trigeminal nerve. The branch of it is the mandibular nerve, the nerve of first arch. 7th nerve is the facial nerve, the nerve of second arch. 9th nerve is the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is the nerve of the third arch. 10th is the vagus nerve, having two branches, important branches supplying the arch. There are many branches, out of which two branches they are related with the arch. First one is superior laryngeal nerve, which is the nerve of fourth arch, and recurrent laryngeal nerve, which is the nerve of sixth arch. So these are the nerves related with the branchial arches or the pharyngeal arches, and the sensory ganglia of these are developed from the epibranchial placos. Okay. Now, as we have seen in the figure, the first one, first cleft, it forms the depression, that is external acoustic meatus. But in our body, we know that external acoustic meatus is surrounded by the pinna. So from where this pinna comes, this is the depression. See the figure. This is the depression giving us external acoustic meatus. Now around this, whatever ectoderm lining the first and the second arch, this ectoderm shows the series of the swelling, and they are called as the hillocks, or the series of the swelling around the first cleft, and they form the pinna or the auricle. Now in the figure you can see this depression is the first cleft. It is giving us external acoustic meatus. Near this cleft, whatever structure is there of the first arch and of the second arch, they show the series of the swellings, and they unite to form the pinna or auricle. So that is about the cleft. Now this is the first arch, and this is lined by ectoderm from outside. It is not the cleft. But this ectoderm also gives us something. So what are the derivatives of this ectoderm? Because remaining all the ectoderms, they are obliterated because of the obliteration of the cervical sinus. So only this ectoderm is remaining. And what does it give? It gives us the skin over the upper and the lower jaw and tragus of the ear. It also gives us, you can go in the sequential manner, it gives us the lips, it gives us the alveolabial sulci, and it gives us the dental lamina. So this dental lamina, which is giving us the future enamel. Okay, so these are the derivatives of the ectoderm of first arch. Now coming to the pharyngeal pouches. Again, what are pharyngeal pouches? Arch is lined by endoderm on inside. So the between two successive arches, this endoderm shows the outpouching, and this outpouching is called as pharyngeal pouch. This pharyngeal pouch, as you can appreciate in the figure, between the two successive arches, this is endoderm lining the inner aspect, and it shows an outpouching. So this is a depression, and that is called as a pharyngeal pouch or the endodermal pouch. There are five pouches. Remember, there are five pouches, or five endodermal or five pharyngeal pouches, out of which the fifth one, the lower one, is very rudimentary. So five pairs of the pharyngeal pouches, out of which the fifth one is very rudimentary. Now, on the ventral aspect, these pouches, they fuse with each other from the right and the left side. They form the floor of the pharynx. And each pouch, as it is width of the neck is there, so each pouch will be having a ventral part and a dorsal part, or you can call it as a ventral wing and dorsal wing. So we have to tell about the derivatives of ventral and the dorsal part of each pharyngeal pouch. So what are the derivatives of first pharyngeal pouch? Derivatives of the first pharyngeal pouch, it will be having a ventral part and dorsal part. Ventral, that is anterior part, it gets obliterated because of the development of the tongue in the floor of the pharynx. So ventral part gets obliterated. Dorsal part of the pharyngeal pouch, first pharyngeal pouch, along with the dorsal part of the second pharyngeal pouch, they together form the tubotympanic recess. Tubotympanic recess. This term includes the tube and a tympanic cavity. And it is having again the distal part and the proximal part. Now, distal part is roomy, it is spacious, and that is forming us the tympanic, that is giving us the tympanic cavity, that is nothing but the middle ear cavity. Along with that, it also gives us the mastoid antrum, mastoid air cells, and the lining of the tympanic membrane, inner lining of the tympanic membrane. Now, in the figure, you can appreciate this is the dorsal part of first pouch, and this becomes the dorsal part of the second pouch. They both fuse together to form the tubotympanic recess. And tubotympanic recess gives us tubo, that is the tube, that is proximal part, which is narrow one. It gives us the eustachian tube or the auditory tube, which is the connection between the nasopharynx and the middle ear cavity. So, tubotympanic recess is giving us tube, that is eustachian tube, and tympanic recess, which is the roomy on the distal part, it gives us the middle ear cavity, the inner lining of the tympanic membrane, mastoid antrum, and mastoid air cells. So these are the derivatives of the tubotympanic recess, which is coming from the dorsal part of the first and dorsal part of the second. Okay, so dorsal part of the first pouch and dorsal part of the second pouch, they fuse to form the tubotympanic recess. In the lower figure, this is the model, and this gap is called as the tubotympanic recess. This is the tubotympanic recess formed by the dorsal part of the first and dorsal part of the second pharyngeal pouch. Ventral part of the first pharyngeal pouch is obliterated because of the developing tongue. Clear? Now coming to the second pouch, derivatives of the second pharyngeal pouch, as you know, it is having again the dorsal part and the ventral part. Dorsal part, again you know that it is taking part in the formation of the tubotympanic recess. Ventral part forms tonsil. It forms the tonsillar cleft or crypt. And you know that in the histologic slide of the tonsil, you always describe the tonsillar crypt. What is that? It is the largest crypt of the tonsil. And that is nothing but the remnant of the second pharyngeal pouch. If the second pharyngeal pouch remains non-obliterated, it remains there patent, then it gives us the intratonsillar cleft or the crypta magna, that is called as the largest crypt, the crypta magna. It is a remnant of non-obliterated part of the second pharyngeal pouch. So you can be asked, what is this tonsillar cleft? It is nothing but the remnant of second pharyngeal pouch. In the model, you can appreciate this is the orange color is indicating development of the tonsil. Tonsil is derivative of the ventral part of the second pharyngeal pouch. Clear? Now coming to the derivatives of the third pharyngeal pouch. Again, third pharyngeal pouch will be having the dorsal part and the ventral part. Dorsal part, it gives us inferior parathyroid. It gives us inferior parathyroid gland. They are also called as parathyroid tree because they are developing from the third pharyngeal pouch. Okay, they are developing from the third pharyngeal pouch and they are called as inferior parathyroid glands. Why? Because they are going down. Okay, that is why they become inferior. How they go down? They go down along the thymus. Thymus is formed from the ventral part of the third pharyngeal pouch. So dorsal part of the third gives us inferior parathyroid, ventral part gives us thymus. Now, both of these, the inferior parathyroid and thymus, they descend down towards the developing heart because they have to come down, because inferior should be inferior to the superior parathyroid. So they come downward, they come towards the developing heart downward. They lose their contact with the pharynx. So pharynx, there is no relation now, and they come downward, the inferior parathyroid and thymus. Soon what happens, the inferior parathyroid also loses its connection with thymus. So first, this inferior parathyroid and thymus lose their connection with the pharynx, they descend down, and then inferior parathyroid loses connection with the thymus also. And then it gets its adult site, that is, it gets permanent attachment with the lower pole of the thyroid gland. You know that there are four parathyroid glands. One pair, that is superior parathyroid, one is inferior parathyroid. The pairs are there. So one pair of the superior parathyroid, one pair of the inferior parathyroid. Inferior parathyroid is developing from the third pharyngeal pouch. And these parathyroids, they are present on the posterior aspect of the thyroid gland. Soon what happens, as you know that inferior parathyroid gets separated from thymus and gets its permanent adult site. This thymus, it descends down from right and left, both the thymic parts, they unite, it descends down in the anterior mediastinum. You know the normal position of this thymus is in the anterior mediastinum. So it descends down there, and you know the histology also. The thymocytes are there. They develop from the bone marrow. They are developed in the bone marrow, so they become mesodermal in origin. And Hassel's corpuscles, they are developing from the third pouch only. So this third pouch means endoderm. So Hassel's corpuscle is endodermal in origin, and thymocytes, they are coming from the bone marrow, so they become mesodermal in origin. So thymus is endodermal in origin, thymocytes are mesodermal in origin, and Hassel's corpuscles, they are again endodermal in origin. So third pharyngeal pouch, dorsal part gives us inferior parathyroid, ventral part gives us thymus, and how they reach to their adult site, that also we have seen. This is the figure showing the parathyroid glands. This is the third pouch, dorsal aspect, giving us parathyroid C, this green part which goes down. So pouch is above, and upper pouch gives us the lower gland. This you have to remember. Upper pouch, that is third pouch, is giving us inferior parathyroid, and fourth pouch is giving us the superior parathyroid. This reverse you have to remember. Okay, now in this lower figure you can appreciate, this is the third pouch having dorsal and ventral part. This dorsal part is giving us inferior parathyroid or parathyroid 3, and this ventral part is giving us thymus. Now both of them, they get separated from the pharynx. They will descend down. Inferior parathyroid will get its adult size attachment to the posterior part of the thyroid gland. And this thymus, green color on both the sides, it will descend down further, and it will be present in the anterior mediastinum. So this is the third pouch. Coming to the derivatives of the fourth pouch, again having the dorsal part and the ventral part. Dorsal part will give us the superior parathyroid. The superior parathyroid is also called as a parathyroid 4 because it is developing from the fourth pharyngeal pouch. Again, it will lose its contact with the pharynx, and it will come to its normal adult position. Okay, it loses the contact with the pharynx, and it will migrate caudally, gain the permanent attachment to the posterior border of lateral lobe of thyroid. So superior and the inferior parathyroid glands, they are present on the posterior aspect of the lateral parathyroid lobe or gland. So this is dorsal part of the fourth pharyngeal pouch. Now coming to the ventral part of the fourth pharyngeal pouch, it is said that it will form the lateral thyroid, because thyroid, when it develops, will be having a medial part and two lateral lobes. So lateral lobes, they are coming from the ventral part. So ventral part will, it may contribute to the thyroid gland in the way, or it forms the lateral thyroid. This is the figure showing the development of the thyroid. Details of the thyroid we will see in the next lecture. But this is the middle part. This is the duct that is called as the thyroglossal duct. This thyroglossal duct will divide into two lobes. These are the, this is the thyroglossal duct, thyroglossal. Glossal means tongue and thyro means thyroid. So this is the thyroglossal duct. This is the middle part. And on either side, there are lateral thyroids which are coming from the ventral part. This ventral part of the fourth pouch gives us these lateral thyroids. So how the thyroid is formed? It is formed by the middle portion, that is the thyroglossal duct, and it is formed or united or fused with the lateral thyroid. This lateral thyroid is coming from the fourth pharyngeal pouch. So that is about the derivatives of the fourth pharyngeal pouch. Dorsal part giving us superior parathyroid and ventral part giving us the lateral thyroid. Now coming to the fifth pharyngeal pouch, mostly it is rudimentary, but in some lower animals, this forms the ultimobronchial body. So it forms the ultimobronchial body. In the human being, it is rudimentary, it is seen only for the brief period. Now, though it is rudimentary, this fifth pharyngeal pouch fuses with the ventral part of the fourth pouch to form this caudal pharyngeal complex. In the human being, there is a structure that is called the caudal pharyngeal complex. Caudal means below. Now the pharynx is ending at the fifth pharyngeal pouch. It is ended almost. So caudal pharyngeal complex means what? It is the fusion of the fifth pharyngeal pouch and ventral part of the fourth pharyngeal pouch, which may contribute in the lateral thyroid. So this is the caudal pharyngeal complex. As it is a complex, it must be having some components. So this caudal pharyngeal complex is having three components. One is the thymic element, because caudal pharyngeal complex is having three parts. Some part is contributing in the development of the thymus, some part is contributing in the formation of the thyroid gland, and some part is giving us ultimobronchial bodies, which gives us the C cells of thyroid gland. So fusion of the ventral part of the fourth and fifth pouch gives us caudal pharyngeal complex. In this caudal pharyngeal complex, you also get the NCC. What is this NCC? Neural crest cells. The neural crest cells, they migrate in this complex. Now components are thymic component, that this thymic component is incorporated in the developing thymus. Lateral thyroid element, which fuses with the medial thyroid element coming from the thyroglossal duct, and it will form the thyroid gland. Third one is ultimobronchial bodies. These ultimobronchial bodies, they form the C cells or the parafollicular cells of thyroid gland. So these are the five pharyngeal pouches. Now we'll see the revision or the table showing all these pharyngeal pouches and their derivatives. So first pouch, having again the dorsal part and ventral part. The dorsal part of the first pouch and dorsal part of the second pouch will form the tubotympanic membrane, and that is giving us the tube that is auditory tube and tympanic, tubotympanic, not membrane, tubotympanic recess. So this is auditory tube and tympanic recess is giving us tympanic cavity, inner lining of the tympanic membrane, mastoid antrum and mastoid air cells. Second, and the ventral part of this first pouch is obliterated because of the developing tongue. Second pouch, dorsal part, ventral part. Dorsal part along with the dorsal part of the first forms tubotympanic recess. Second pouch, ventral part forms the palatine tonsil, tonsillar fossa and intratonsillar cleft. This intratonsillar cleft is nothing but the remnant of second pharyngeal pouch. Third pouch, dorsal part, ventral part. Dorsal part gives us inferior parathyroid gland, ventral part gives us thymus. Fourth pouch, again dorsal and ventral. Dorsal part gives us superior parathyroid gland and ventral part contributes in the lateral thyroid. Caudal pharyngeal complex, how it is formed? Fifth pouch, ventral part of fourth pouch and neural crest cells. It is having three components, thymic component which gives the part of the thymus, lateral thyroid element which gives us the part of the thyroid and ultimobronchial bodies which gives the parafollicular cells or C cells. Now again this is the revision of the figure showing the derivatives of pharyngeal pouches. Tubotympanic recess formed by the dorsal part of the first and the second. This is the tonsil developing from the ventral part of the second pharyngeal pouch. Third pharyngeal pouch, dorsal part giving us parathyroid tree and thymus is formed from the ventral part. Fourth pharyngeal pouch, dorsal part giving us superior parathyroid and ventral part is giving us the lateral thyroid element. This is the model which we'll see in the next lecture in detail. This figure is showing all the structures again, same structure. This is the ear and this is the external auditory meatus. These are the derivatives of the first pharyngeal cleft. This is the derivative of the first pharyngeal pouch. Second pharyngeal pouch giving us tonsil. Third pharyngeal pouch giving us inferior parathyroid gland and thymus. Fourth pharyngeal pouch is giving us superior parathyroid gland and the part of the thyroid gland. So that is all the model we will see in the next lecture. In the next lecture, we have to see the applied importance of the arches, the first arch syndrome. And we'll see the two models. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Are you able to take the notes?
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
You have taken the notes? Yes or no?
No, ma'am.
Yes,
yes. So next time we'll see the models, pharyngeal pouch and pharyngeal arches, and we'll complete the applied importance of pharyngeal arches, that is first arch syndrome. Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Bye,
ma'am.
आपको जो मतलब एक्सचेंज के बता हाँ
सही चल रहा है ऊपर
ये
नहीं है।